Niranjan, good morning. Great to have you here with us.
Morning to you, Abba. It's lovely having you too.
It's a fabulous day, and especially to talk about some of the growth that we've seen. You've in fact multiplied your wealth, I think, five times just in the last 5 years. So it continues to grow manifold despite all of the growth that you've seen over the last few decades. What's the story? How are you managing to do that?
I don't know about managing it, but I think India has continuous chances and opportunities where we can actually grow ourselves. And it's only when you pass the 60s that you understand that the handicaps and the opportunities seem to be both there available to you. What is really wonderful is that I think we were able to do the right things at the right time.
Sure.
And some of them really panned out extremely well. Mm-hmm. And most of it, of course, was in my core competency,
yes,
which is real estate.
Yes.
So I think it has been quite a lot of fun.
What are some of the milestone moments for you? I mean, what you've developed in Powai, of course, has turned out to be a signature project for the group. But what were some of those key moments, particularly, for example, even if you go as far back as the decision to get into real estate?
So talking about the paradigm really was sometimes hard decisions.
Yeah.
Like, for instance, we had the commercial assets in Powai. I swore to myself that I would never in my lifetime sell any of those assets.
Right.
And we kind of decided that we sell them about 3 years ago, and we sold them to Brookfield for $1 billion.
Remember?
That was kind of a very difficult decision because we tend to fall in love with our properties.
Of course.
And what happens is that at that time, to say that, okay, let's be businesslike rather than holding on. And I think that helped us tremendously because once we did that, we were able to take a new role completely. While most of the other developers and other people tend to hold on and just piled on debt.
Exactly.
So I think that was a big difference.
And there's no stopping you now. You've actually got a lot of projects that are on the radar, a lot of things that are going to come on stream. Talk to us a little bit about that in the real estate space first, and then I'll get to the other.
Well, in the real estate space, we are growing continuously. The parent company has expanded in Powai. We've continued to grow much faster than we did before. Thane has seen a leap beyond imagination. Mm. We've grown sevenfold in the last 5 years. So I think that's been quite an interesting journey.
Right.
We've, of course, now added on a lot more projects. We have added on Panvel, which is taking off and in a very beautiful way. We will deliver about 2,250 apartments by next year. Wow. We have already delivered about 1,000 apartments this year with occupation certificate, to say.
Yes.
We've got a project in Chennai, which is 380 acres.
Yeah.
And we're now going to do a very, very new and interesting project in Alibaug.
Interesting.
Yes. So that's 250 acres, which is as big as Powai. But we plan to do a kind of a touristy township.
Okay.
So a kind of a mix of a
Would that
a
be
home,
the first, first of its kind?
The first that I know of.
Sure.
So if people could live in Alibaug and work there. And probably come to work in the city because the RoRo is starting in the first week of February.
Yes.
So you can take your car into the boat and come down to South Bombay. So why would you like to stay in the city? Why not stay in Alibaug and enjoy the kind of a
thing? Sounds like a plan.
So something different is what we want to do.
Fabulous. You also have a whole new set of businesses that you're excited about, the data centers, for example. Talk to us a little bit about what's brewing on that front.
Okay, so we have two new businesses which we have started in 2019.
Hmm.
The first one being data centers.
Yeah.
We've set up an entire separate platform called Yota, and we launched it around June of the last year. And we plan to have it operational by the end of this month.
Right.
So the first center, which will be the fastest in the world.
Sure.
So, and it'll be an investment of almost 1,000 crores in 6 months.
Right.
So it's a large data center that we have planned. And we plan to grow this business both in Mumbai and Chennai at the first instance, and then afterwards maybe other locations. So that's a big leap that we have taken. The second one is the logistics and industrial parks. There we put up a platform where Blackstone has joined us on a 50-50 joint venture partnership. And that also has taken off. The first deals have been signed in Chennai with Vestas. And in Talegaon, which is in Pune, we plan is also getting worked out very nicely. So these are two new businesses that we have gone into.
What's the kind of opportunity you see on both these fronts? I mean, you've made significant investments, you've got key investors. What's the kind of scale and opportunity here?
So on the data center, I think the growth would be immense, unbelievably immense, simply because data is growing so fast and you really need it. E-commerce is growing fast, banking and finance is growing fast. All this will require good data centers to come in. The second part of it is really the opportunity in terms of doing services by bringing data into the country.
Right.
And the Prime Minister has been talking about it too.
Sure.
So I think that's an opportunity really which we think we should be able to do in the next couple of years.
Okay. And you know, when you touched upon the government, so in the current environment as well, you know, while your projects are of course on track, but you've also been, you know, at the helm of so many industry bodies, do you see things improving anytime soon?
I do see a lot of effort made by the government now for the purposes of making the changes. You've seen multiple budgets come in order to rectify the wrongs. See, whenever the markets are down, irrespective of which country it is, you have to take strong steps to rectify it.
Sure.
So I think the challenge has been not the fact that they have not taken steps, but because the challenges are greater, we need many more steps to be taken in order to make this paradigm happen. I mentioned it earlier. I said you can't give crocin for cancer. And so you have to give chemotherapy. They started it with the first round by reducing the tax on corporates. I think you need a correction in the GST. We need a strong infusion in terms of infrastructure and development, which is going to start. So I think a combination of all this.
Okay.
I think we do need something to move from the liquidity side from the Reserve Bank of India, because I'm in ASSOCHAM, as you mentioned, one of the institutions. We have 4,50,000 members. Almost 2 lakh are strapped for liquidity. So I think, you know, it's not a joke anymore.
Sure.
People, you know, laugh about it. No, 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 it'll be all right. And
it's a serious situation.
It's really not that case. You have to. You have to make that change, and it has to happen quickly. So I think we need one there. The second thing that I need from the Reserve Bank is a one-time rollover for credit limits, as was done in 2008 during the Lehman crisis.
Right.
So what did they do that time? Those credit limits which are there, which are strapped, the bank at their option could extend those things or roll it over, subject to terms and conditions, if the bank or the banks will put and RBI will mandate. We need that again.
Okay.
Because
okay.
otherwise, companies which are positive net worth are strapped for liquidity and are going under. Mm. And that's wrong.
Have you seen a similar situation in your career so far, this kind of stress and pain on the sector?
Oh, yeah, we have seen pain, but we haven't seen it for so long and so deep.
Okay.
So stress, every three, four years, I think every industry does go through it, the ups and downs, cyclical economic cycles.
Yeah.
But I haven't seen a stress so deep continue for so long. Hmm. Mostly 3 months, 6 months, 8 months max.
Sure.
But this is really extended much longer. And hence, we need a far greater attention to it than we have had actually.
And what what enthralls me is the fact that even at this stage, and you continue to grow, you're still so passionate about carving a niche, building these projects. Where do you find that momentum from?
See, my father, I'll tell you a short story of my father. My father was a doctor, an ENT surgeon. One morning at 6 o'clock in the morning, when we used to have cups of teas sometimes together, when I would wake up that early, and he told me, I want to go to Germany, age 82, to learn a new operation.
Okay.
82. And he wants to learn a new operation from a Dr. Plester in Germany. And I said, wasn't he the doctor who came to learn an operation from you 5 years ago? So he said, yes, the same doctor. But now he has something to teach
me. Right, right.
So if a person at 82, a doctor can go and learn from another doctor at age 82 and enthusiastic. But take the case of Leela, Captain Nair.
True.
Captain Nair started his career of the Leela at age 60, 62.
Yes.
So, I mean, age is a number now, if you take care of your health and God is with you.
Yes.
And he gives you that energy and possibility and lovely people like you to get interviewed by. I think a combination of all that makes life worth living.
Oh, that's, that's lovely. So when it comes to, you know, the projects that you were speaking about, again, of course, Alibaug is going to be exciting. You've talked about Panvel. You've talked about the kind of scale as well. So where do you see the business or the group from the real estate angle in, let's say, the next 3 to 5 years?
To be honest, I don't know. But I can tell you that the children are quite different and they want to do it differently. My son is in the LNG and the gas business. And his target is that in 5 years from today, he will be bigger than me in turnover.
Wow, okay.
So, it's,
where is he currently at? The current turnover?
I'll have to check. So, the issue basically being that there are opportunities, but it not necessarily the same way and the manner in which you talk about it yesterday and today. It's going to change. And his first gas terminal in Ratnagiri is going to be operational in terms of delivering gas to the country. And he's created another paradigm, which is reducing gas prices by 15% for India.
Okay.
So that's a big thing which is happening.
Huge opportunity.
So I can tell you the next couple of years, because we have the plans on our place, and he has his plan, and my daughter has her plans from London. But I'm not able to tell you what are the new opportunities that will come up.
There could be many others.
But India is going to be a place where opportunities will keep coming, and a huge number.
Okay. All right. On that note, let's take a very quick break. We're in conversation with Niranjan Hiranandani. We'll be back in just a moment. What a beautiful home, Niranjan. Thank you for welcoming us here. And this is the first time you've opened the doors to anyone, anyone from the media.
Yes.
So we're very privileged to be here. And I mean, I know that, you know, there's a lot of thought that's gone into the interiors, but you're in particular excited about some of the lighting here. Right?
Oh, well, you know, every place that you do, whether it's a building, whether it's architecture, you think of two things.
Sure.
One is space planning.
Okay.
How are you going to use the space? So whether it's Powai or Thane or whatever it is, space planning is a passion for me.
Right.
And so the spaces I'm good at.
Okay.
The aesthetics I like to look at. But I don't really look at the nitty-gritties.
Okay.
So I can't take the credit for everything that has happened. The architects really do a good job.
Right.
But I sign off.
Yes.
Including the chair.
Which is the most important part.
Yeah.
All right. So, you know, a lot of entrepreneurs look up to your story to try and understand how they can somehow emulate it, how they can somehow find success. You've already started to instill some of those qualities in your own children as well. They have some interesting stories of how they started businesses in their early 20s and succeeded. Talk to us about some of the values that you have brought them up with.
I wish I could take all the credit for what they did, but nevertheless, they are my children, so I can say I'm their Bob.
Yes.
So on that account, I could take some of the credit. Let's take Priya, for instance. Age 23. She joins our company after becoming a chartered accountant and working for another consulting firm. She joins my place, and within 6 months, she gets bored and says, Papa, I'm not working for you anymore. I want to do something new.
Right.
Then after that, she comes back and says, I'm bored of working with you. Why are you bored? She says, Papa, if I did things rightly, they would say, you know, Niranjan's son, so bound to do it rightly. And
right.
if I do it wrongly, Niranjan's son, and you don't know
don't
how
know
to
how.
Do it right. So there is a no-win situation
sure.
working with you, so I want
sure.
to do on my own.
Okay.
So I said, what do you want to do? She comes back again after a couple of weeks or months. And when she was 23, she's past 40 now, and she comes and tells me, Papa, I wanted to start a call center. And I said, what's a call center? At that time, I was not so knowledgeable about it. So she says and explains me what's a call
right.
center. And I said, telephone operating business?
Yeah.
And she says, Papa, you're too old. And that I'm telling you a story of long
right.
back. And that's how the children look at you, you know. So that was it. She started it at age 23. Let's fast forward, age 27 and a half. She had 4,500 employees from 12 that she started. And she sold that business, Zenta Technologies, to an American company for a valuation of $100 million.
What are some of the, you know, unique challenges you feel entrepreneurs today face? You know, you've given examples of your children that have embarked onto new businesses. You know, let's say for an entrepreneur who could perhaps be starting out with absolutely nothing, but just with a dream, what do you feel are some of the unique challenges today?
First of all, you have to understand that the opportunity today is a billion times easier than what it was when we were there. First of all, capital was just not available.
Sure, sure.
We, at some points of our business, we were borrowing monies at 2% per month. And it was not available.
Right.
The banks never dealt with us and things
right.
like that. So
right.
that's capital is much easier for the younger children.
Sure.
Number two, the venture capital funds,
yeah.
which is now available to the kids who start off these new ventures, is so much that there are equal number of venture capitalists chasing people,
sure.
who young people to do it. So it's much easier.
Yeah.
But the understanding definitely is different, in the sense that the challenges we faced in terms of capital and other stuff are equally different today, because the technology world and the world of information is so fast
sure,
and quick
sure.
that irrespective of the newness of the schemes that they come up with, if they're not constantly innovating, they're out of date.
Sure.
So let's say something of technology that I imbibed in real estate or something would last me 10 years or 15 years on new ideas. Today, that would not last for 10 months. So unless you didn't do new things in the next 10 months, I think you would get out of date. And the same thing is true even of our business today.
Sure, sure.
So in the real estate business, we constantly innovate in terms of whatever we are doing, and we have to keep on improving those parts of it and all.
Okay, I am curious about these lights. So tell me a little bit about them. you have a disco theater
so
going on.
So we can
in here.
Convert this into a disco theater. You can change the lights if you want to see it. We'll show it to you.
Yes, I would love to see it.
it's a lot of fun. I hope I can operate it.
Let's have a look. This is the thing about technology, right?
Yeah, you really have to...
Oh, look at that.
So that's disco lighting for you, and
okay.
you can have music and all that stuff also into the whole thing.
This is fabulous. I like the red shades. I can see, you know, quite a few different scenes playing out.
Yeah.
Fun. Fantastic. So here's the thing about technology, right? Keeps you...
You're always challenged.
Exactly.
And there's always newness that you can think of
that's
and play
so
with
wonderful.
It, and it's all fun.
Yes. So, you know, talking about the youth, I'm also interested in some of the work that you're doing with regards to creating jobs, education, skilling, because isn't that the need of the hour? And, you know, we're already talking so much about the lack of jobs in the current market and the fact that even if there are jobs, there are mismatched skill sets. It's a big worry for India.
I think education is a big subject that I've been interested in for the last 20 years. We've been working on it. I connect myself with 17 colleges in Mumbai and 8 schools and 2 hospitals, and we have a skill development center.
Okay.
So we think that there is a huge opportunity to upgrade all this, both at the primary level, where I think schools need improvement, they need technology to really do it, and to outreach people all over, including the villages, including the schools that are happening. And I think now the recognition is there that we need to do it. The state Maharashtra government has also given us a separate university, a cluster university, which we are starting by June of this year, which will really bring liberal education, and which will bring things like you could do a science subject along with taking a subject of accountancy, or doing science and doing a management course. And you could study in any of our colleges and get credits in them even now. So at this age too, I mean, I could do that too. So I think the whole concept of education is undergoing a change, and I'm looking forward to it tremendously. The second part is what the Prime Minister has been talking about, skilling India. We have, of course, been working more on the poorest of poor. And the last 1 year, we've skilled about 5,500 poorest of the poor who have been skilled, and each one of them have got better jobs. And it's been a tremendous satisfaction as to what we've been able to do. Many of these courses, which are now on, don't really get you ready for the industry or business or commerce. So people come out and they say, oh, but we are not fit for any job. And that's scary.
That is scary. I mean, do you see that boost in job growth in India delayed? I mean, in the next couple of years, do you see that visibility?
No, I think the opportunity will grow, but we have to bring in the right training, the right schooling, the right colleges, the right institutions to bring coaching on that. Of course, a lot will change with technology. And I believe at least 30% in the next 5 years will be through through online courses and through your mobile phone.
Amazing.
Yes.
You know, Niranjan, you've talked about how you are spending more time on some of these things, and you know, you're giving back, and at the same time also exploring all those new exciting opportunities. As someone who has it all, you know, what to you is the biggest mark of achievement? Is it about constantly having that figure in the turnover or in the net worth? Is it about leaving behind a legacy? Is it about being someone who could influence, you know, the way India evolves as a country and as an opportunity? What would it be for you?
I would say the first stage of my life was really about myself, me, myself, me, myself and my family. Today, it's all about giving back. So all the growth which is there, I promise you, my expenditure and my wife's expenditure has come down over a period of years rather than grown. So our need for money is really not there. The second part is really growth, because if you grow the whole thing, that's where people with you really grow. And I think ultimately the quality of life for the country must improve. So I think the stage in the last 5 years plus is really being given back to society in terms of what you can possibly give. And a large part of the whole idea has been on that side. The business has to grow because you have to generate wealth. But more than grow, the growth is not for growing per se, but really to create a paradigm. So when you make your projects, you have to see that the buildings last 100 years, that the people who live there are find the buildings best and easy to maintain, that they love the spaces, that they're happy there. Now, if I thought that we could set up the precedence for these kind of buildings, other people copy and emulate all those ideas. When they copy it, they also make good quality buildings. They also make places which people are happy about. So I think it's about setting a precedent and then, you know, bringing about a manifold change in the entire country. I think that is my objective, and which really makes me very happy that we can give back to society what we have been able to get in munificent quantities.
Nicely said. Niranjan, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. My pleasure, Abba.
And for inviting us to your home. Thank you.
Thank you.